Which food sensitivity test will help you get the results you're looking for? Keep watching to find out. If you're new here, hi there, my name's Amanda Malacheski. I'm a functional nutrition health coach and a digestive and allergy detective. I help you figure out what foods and lifestyle habits are gonna help you improve your gut and allergy health. So if you'd like to find out more about this and hear when I release new videos, go ahead and subscribe to my channel and make sure you hit the bell to be notified when I release a new video each week. Food sensitivity and food allergy tests are kind of all the rage right now. People are really into using them, but I find that a lot of people misunderstand how to use them properly. So today I want to talk about how to choose the right test based on your circumstances. Choosing the right tests can help you get the kinds of results that you'd like to with your digestion and allergies to reduce your symptoms, like they did for my client Mary, who used a food sensitivity test to figure out which specific foods were aggravating her IBS symptoms, her bloating, and diarrhea. So you can do this too, so let's get started. The first thing I need to share with you today is something you may or may not know, but it's that there are different types of food allergies. I'm gonna say that again. There are different types of food allergies. A lot of my clients come to me saying that, oh yeah, my doctor already ran an allergy test, a food allergy test, and I didn't have any food allergies. But usually what's happened is that their doctor has run skin pinprick allergy tests, and these test for only one type of allergy, which is the IgE mediated allergies, which are kind of what we think of as traditional allergies. So if you have IgE allergies, you're maybe getting hives, runny nose, runny eyes, in worst case scenario, anaphylactic shock and death from ingesting things like peanuts or shellfish or these things that people are often highly allergic to. But there are other types of food sensitivities, and these are the kind that are much more interesting to me as a nutrition practitioner. So I want to get clear together about what the different types of allergies are that are possible so that we know exactly what we're looking for when we decide what kind of testing to use. So the first type of allergy, like I mentioned a moment ago, is an IgE mediated allergy. And these IgG things are the different antibody clusters that attach to an allergen in your body to tag them for destruction by the immune system. So the IgE allergies are the type, like I said, that are sort of a histamine anaphylactic type reaction to an allergen. You probably already know if you are severely allergic to something like this. So only a small percentage of people actually have this type of allergy. The second kind of food allergies or sensitivities are IgG mediated allergies. So again, IgG just means it's a different branch of the immune system that's tagging things for immune system destruction. IgG sensitivities often cause a delayed response. They can be as many as 3 to 4 days after ingestion. So this makes them kind of challenging and difficult to track, and maybe a reason why you have odd reactions at odd times that you can't necessarily track back to a particular event. This type of reaction is often involved with low-grade inflammatory conditions and autoimmunity. The third type of allergies or sensitivities that I often see are reactions to a naturally occurring component of a perfectly healthy food. So examples of these are things like gluten, FODMAPs, which are types of starches in particular kinds of foods, or something like lactose, which is a component of dairy products. So now that we've talked about the different types of allergies, let's talk a little bit about testing. So if you're someone who deals with sort of a traditional hay fever style of allergy, or you really strongly react to certain foods within the first 30 minutes after ingestion, I highly suggest that you go get a skin pinprick allergy test from a traditional allergist if you haven't already done this. This can definitely be a life-saving measure to take, and it can also just help you understand which kinds of things you're reacting to. It tests for various kinds of foods, environmental allergens like molds and pollens, and also things like pet dander, pet hair, and stuff like that, cats, dogs, those sorts of things. So it really does help to understand which things you're reacting to, and that can help you manage your home environment for better health for your allergies. If you're someone who seems to have delayed food responses that kind of occur on a rolling basis, and you can't seem to pinpoint exactly where or when they're starting or where they're coming from, I suggest using either an IgG food sensitivity test or what's called a mediator release test. These are typically blood tests. Some of them are done at home. Some of them you have to go to a lab to have drawn. And they test for a wide variety of foods. Some of the labs you might choose are Immunolaboratories IgG panel, Neurogistics IgG panel, US Biotech's IgG panel, the Mediator release test from Oxford Biomedical Laboratories, and also the C-Rex Array number 10 food sensitivity panel. The costs for these different tests vary a bit, and they all test for slightly different foods, but largely they cover the sort of most commonly consumed foods, including grains, dairy products, meats, vegetables, fruits, oils, etc. The trick with these results is to understand how to use them properly, and I'm a pretty big advocate for having someone professional to help you read the results and figure out what you need to do. But generally, if you are showing a reaction to these foods, you'll want to remove them for a period of time. The time will depend on the severity of the reaction to the food, and then you'll reintroduce them one at a time to assess for a reaction. So it's like you kind of use the test as a tool to figure out your strategy for how to see, am I really reacting to this? Am I having a reaction that I can notice? For the third type of food sensitivity, which is sensitivity to a particular component of a natural food, the best form of testing truly is a true elimination and reintroduction diet, sometimes with a lab assist to get additional information. So for example, if you suspect you have gluten sensitivity, a FODMAP sensitivity, or lactose intolerance, then you want to do a thorough elimination diet for 3 to 4 weeks, and then it reintroduce the foods that you eliminated one by one to see if you can notice a reaction. If you do have a reaction, then those are foods that you should probably continue to avoid for a little while you then do investigation underneath to figure out why is my body reacting to this food. If you'd like a little more specific information about how to do an elimination and reintroduction diet, you can check out my earlier video called How to Do an Elimination Diet for IBS. But then in some cases, lab tests can be an additional support to this process of investigating what's going on. So a particular example here is with gluten sensitivity. So two lab tests in particular can be really valuable here. One is the C-Rex Array number 10, which tests for sensitivity to gluten proteins and antibodies to gluten, as well as foods that the body commonly cross-reacts to with gluten sensitivity, including certain gluten-free grains and dairy products. The other test is called the Wheat Zoomer from Vibrant Wellness, and this test also tests for antibodies to gluten and various pieces to that puzzle, but it also can test for the celiac genes. It can help you understand if you're actually at risk for celiac disease based on your genetics. So I'm curious, have you ever used a food sensitivity test? And if so, what did it teach you? Go ahead and leave us a comment below. As you can see, each of you is totally unique and probably needs a really unique approach to figuring out what exactly your food sensitivities are. I hope this video helped clarify some things for you and sort out which food sensitivity tests might be valuable for you to investigate further. But if you're still confused and you need a little bit of additional help figuring out which tests might be right for you, I encourage you to schedule yourself a free 30-minute assessment session with me. You can schedule that by visiting me at confluencenutrition.com/contact. Investigative lab testing is just one piece of the puzzle I use to help my clients sort out their digestive and allergy challenges. To find out more about the other 6 steps on my roadmap to gut recovery, you can grab your free copy at confluencenutrition.com/roadmap. That's all for this week, and I hope that this video was helpful for you. If it was helpful for you, please go ahead and click like down below and leave us a comment. Thanks for watching, everyone. I'll be here next week. In the meantime, if you have any questions about what you saw in this video, or if you have a question that you'd like answered in a future video, please be sure and leave me a question down below in the comments. I really do read those comments. And be sure and share this video with your friends and family if you feel it could be useful for them. All right, I'll see you next time.